No Fate Project Report, March 2021, Timeline K1.
This is Derek Johnson bringing you a roundup of kaiju news from around the world. The world has finally seen its first real-life kaiju clashes, starting in Australia with the Battle of Victoria's St. Kilda, an apparently decisive battle in the Emu War II. Two massive orniths faced off in the beachfront community of St. Kilda, Australia's giant emu, Mega-Dromaius, and North America's three-headed bald eagle, bird of prey. After the bald eagle's radioactive trail of carnage through the Pacific and the emu's bloody rampage across Australia's south coast, at first, the two megafowls seemed evenly matched as they tussled through the park, sending picnickers screaming as they wrestled, but neither laying any heavy blows. Then Dromaius got a few brutal hits in with her beak, piercing the lower abdomen of the bald eagle. She nearly hit lower, but the bird of prey retreated into the sky. Then he turned this position into a natural advantage. Flying just out of range, the dynamic demon shamelessly taunted the flightless bird, flying just close enough to give the poor creature false hope. This schoolyard bullying lasted some time, with the taloned tormentor teasing and dodging, wearing out its prey. Finally, the three-headed tormentor released a single sustained blast of radiation that knocked his victim to the ground. The bald eagle then held the weakened emu down with his talons and tore into her belly with his beak, eating his prey alive, apparently unconcerned by the radiation. As her blood visibly spread into the ocean, the Dromaius shrieked in otherworldly agony. Finally, the North American pillager ripped his victim's head off, mercifully ending her pain. Although human onlookers initially celebrated an unexpected win in Australia's Emu War II, the celebrations didn't last long as the American aggressor proceeded to blast the beachfront community with radiation. St. Kilda's backpackers, rich whites, and hospitality workers fled to the Melbourne city center, finding shelter in St. Paul's Cathedral. Once South Melbourne was entirely flattened and irradiated, the North American bird of prey headed home via the Pacific Ocean. That evening, Prime Minister Scott Morrison profusely thanked the American bird of prey for his assistance in this decisive battle, adding that this strengthens the special relationship between Australia and the United States. Yet Morrison underlined that the second Emu War is not over, as Australia still has normal-sized flightless birds without any superpowers that remain undefeated by Australia's best men.
Yeah, for context, I tend to call the Emu War Australia's Vietnam, their great defining loss. In the 30s, the military attempted to clear out all emus, and the emus won. An imperialist military lost against a flightless bird. All of this has happened before, and all of this will happen again, and nobody has a plan.
When asked about the loss of human life, Morrison replied that the collateral damage was regrettable but unavoidable. Apparently believing his mic was off, Morrison commented that as a left-leaning state, Victoria is an acceptable sacrifice zone. This week saw a second clash of titans, this time in North Africa. The chimeric Antarctic protector met dung beetle the aggregator, the first clash between a protector and a destroyer. After a couple of months cleaning up the zombie plague in Europe, the protector crossed the Mediterranean Sea and met the aggregator in Egypt's East Desert. The Antarctic chimera appeared weary in the heat, panting and sluggish. After some time posturing, the clash itself was nasty, brutish, and short. First, the dung beetle knocked his opponent flat with his giant ball of aggregated debris. Showing no mercy, the big bug repeated the attack twice over, like a driver reversing over roadkill. After stopping the fourth attack with both arms, The humiliated protector retreated into the Red Sea. As a land-based kaiju, the aggregator accepted this white flag and headed on a journey to Jerusalem to aggregate more debris for his doom ball. Meanwhile, the protector was apparently healed by the water, their wounds glowing green as they healed, and they headed down the Red Sea inlet towards the wider Indian Ocean.
So the bad guys are on a rampage as usual, but Dr. Tate is initiating a project to create a kind of projected Antarctic microclimate around the protector so they can cope with those hotter climes.
Good, it's the least we can do with the protector saving our asses from the zombie plague. Also, since conventional weapons don't work, backing the protectors against the destroyers is a good strategy. Anyway, in European kaiju news, Hazel and the Nutcrackers, the British scurry of red squirrels, are currently scurrying down the Channel Tunnel on the way to France after wiping out much of southeast England. A proposal to cave the tunnel in has met resistance from the transport industry. Meanwhile, in South America, Mito, the Brazilian macaw, besieged Brazil's capital with her fire breath, killing thousands of innocents. And finally, in Japan, Big Tanuki successfully cleaned up all of Japan's nuclear waste with his healing blasts, paid visits to Hiroshima and Nagasaki, then joined the Pacific Ocean. Environmentalists worldwide have adopted Tanuki as a symbol, showing up on placards everywhere.
Team Tanuki.
Damn straight. So what about station news? I heard the Pikmin Foundation over at Miskatonic pulled their funding from Dire Station. What's the background on that?
So they demanded that Tate be removed from the head of No Fate Project. They gave an ultimatum that they'd pull all funding if she wasn't replaced with that weird creep Morel from Miskatonic.
Did they say why?
They claimed incompetence, but that's a lie.
So what's the real reason?
No idea, but Tate put her leadership to a vote, and everyone but Morel backed her.
Why do you think the vote came out that way?
Well, Tate's recruited everyone else to that Global Protection Society thing.
Protector worship?
Yeah.
But she hasn't recruited you.
Team Tanuki.
So why vote for Tate?
Well, Tanuki wasn't a candidate, sadly, but the Protector Worshippers are aligned with Tanuki. Tate believes the No Fate Project mission statement. She's all about reversing the sixth mass extinction, and she's gay.
You should be her campaign manager. And Morel?
He looks like Ben Shapiro. In his favor, though, he's probably also gay.
How do you figure?
90% sure he bottomed for Don Levy.
So basically there are no straight people left on the station?
Not since you blasted Bob and Keir's heads off.
They were zombies.
I'm not judging, just stating a fact. Anyway, Morel's not politically gay. Neither him nor Don Levy ever came to the station's pride events. More importantly, there's his actual political allegiance. So obviously he's with the Pikmin Foundation and their exact agenda is unknown. But it's clearly not a good agenda, right? They seem pretty malicious. So the foundation followed through on their threat. They withdrew all funding save for keeping Morel on. So after all the corporations basically have pulled out, Vertical Court and the pharma companies, that just leaves New Zealand funding the project. So now we're restructuring, they're dumping all the climate change research.
Damn.
Yeah, they're stripping down to just kaiju division and temporal manipulation. Then there's the Pikmin Foundation funding Morel's little one-man history project.
What's the history project again?
Well, you know William Dyer.
As in Dyer Station? The explorer it's named after?
Yeah, so the project seems to be mostly interpreting his diary from that mysterious 30s expedition.
Oh, yeah. Don Levy was obsessed with that diary. Leather bound with an ornate key, right?
Yeah, it was pretty styly. But why obsess over an old diary on a station where you can easily make phone calls to the past?
All hail the time phone, but remember, it only goes back 12 months. Have you noticed we haven't been getting those monthly calls from future Derek?
Yeah, I didn't want to say, but the last was in October?
If the calls go back 12 months, what happens in October 2021?
Unknown. So we've got a few months to find out, I guess. Even if future Derek's not alive anymore, you'd think somebody from the project would call us. But if there's no hope in the future, maybe there's hope in the past.
Reactionary.
Point is, we should contact our past selves to prevent the kaiju from arising in the first place, you know, much like the zombies. Now we're from the future. Tate reckons the Temporal Ethics Committee should give us permission to use the time phone soon.
Here's hoping.
Yeah, here's hoping. Any news at your end?
Well, I visited Don Levy in the hospital.
Oh, that's sweet.
Well, remember, I put him there. Mm. He kept guarding himself down there as if he has anything to guard. He's waiting for a transplant. If he gets one, I'll rip them off again.
Ruthless.
Yep, I have no ruth when it comes to that man. He endangered you, not to mention humanity, for profit. I only left him alive because dead men don't feel pain. He's with the Pikmin Foundation now.
Why?
Money. These guys make any publicly listed megacorp look like a neighborhood dairy. Old money. Catholic Church style.
What do they need Don Levy for?
Far as I can tell, research, development, and more importantly, secrets.
Would he divulge any secrets with you?
Of course not.
Damn. Anything else to report?
I binged season 7 of Crooklyn 98. It was pretty fun for propaganda.
Agreed. I keep a hard separation in my head between fiction cops and real cops. So, what are your plans for the night?
Nothing.
We could have a one-handed video call.
Get out of my brain. Okay, listeners, we need some privacy, so that's it from us. Please donate to patreon.com/jetpack1917 if you want to help prevent the kaiju apocalypse. Good night and good luck. And if there is one, we'll see you in the future.
Don't make me wait for your love. Don't make me wait for your love.